Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you're enjoying dinner so far. It is now my honor to invite on stage our guest of honor, President Tharman Shanmugaratnam, President of the Republic of Singapore, for a dialogue session. And moderating that dialogue session is Mr. Robin Hu, Advisor and Senior Director of Temasek. President Tharman and Mr. Hu, please.
Mr. President, we are indeed privileged and honored to have you here.
My pleasure.
This evening.
Thank you.
And the opportunity to tap into your vast intellect comes only very rarely. So I'm sure we are in for a real treat in the next half an hour or so. Now, Mr. President, we live in fairly exciting and dangerous times as climate change and the loss of biodiversity is threatening humanity. 70% of the earth is covered by water. And 97% of that is salt water. So therefore, the 3% that is remaining, mostly locked in ice caps and glaciers. So it's really, humanity survives on 1% of the water on Earth, and that represents, I think, quite sobering thought. A World Resource Institute report tells us that 51 out of 164 countries are expected to suffer from high water stress by 2050, and that's about 31% of the world population. Agriculture today accounts for 72% of the global freshwater withdrawals. In India and Ethiopia, that's 90%. It's fair to say that water efficiency in the agriculture sector across the world is very poor. Industrialization is also putting water under stress. Half of the 60 largest economies in the world are at risk of water shortages unless climate crisis is averted. So therefore, the picture is really quite grim. Are you hopeful that we're able to save humanity from a water Armageddon?
Well, I treat that as a rhetorical question. There are reasons for deep concern. But the same reasons, I think, offer grounds for optimism. First, I hate to say this, but the problems have to be apparent enough, deep enough, and felt enough for people to realize that we have to act on them. It is tragic that we've got longer droughts, more intense floods, and a whole set of problems around the world, one region after another, one country after the next. But that's also why minds are being focused. And that's also why it's harder to be a climate denialist today than it was, say, 5 years ago, because the problems are obvious. And they're not only in a distant part of the world, they're very close to where you are. I think there are grounds for optimism, partly because there's that growing realization on the part of ordinary people and the growing difficulty to be a denialist. But I'm also optimistic because when you think about water, first and foremost, the source of the problem isn't natural, it is human-made. The source of the problem is mismanagement, gross mismanagement for decades, both of the sources of supply of water, as well as the way we use water, the demand for water. And if that is the case, if we are mismanaging water so badly, it also means we can manage it better. If it was human-made, if the problem was human-made, it can also be human-solved, and we can come to that later. It requires, first, some basic reorientations in the way we understand the problem and the way we understand that we are all in this. It affects all of us. It's not just about another country that's having a very severe drought or severe flood or that's finding its cities subsiding, which is happening all over the world. It's actually a global problem. And understanding the science and presenting the science in ways that people can understand is, I think, a very important priority. Democratizing the science. The two key shifts or reorientations in thinking that we need, and in fact, the Global Commission that I am privileged to co-chair would be advocating this, is first we've got to understand that we are interdependent in many more ways than we think. We used to think about water interdependence in terms of the rivers that happen to cross boundaries, sometimes a lake, and for some countries even a pipeline through which we import water from a neighboring country. That's one form of interdependence, but there's a much larger form of interdependence that science now tells us about. And that is the interdependence that comes from the atmospheric rivers, the atmospheric flows of moisture that connect countries and regions, in fact, connect large parts of the world with each other. It's not something that's as visible as a river or even groundwater, but it accounts for more than half of the rainfall we get. More than half of the rainfall we get actually comes from plant life, from what's called green water, the water that's in the surface of the soil, in the plants, and that is eventually, through transpiration, ends up in the atmosphere and comes back through precipitation. More than half of the rainfall that we depend on comes from green water, not the water that we see, which you might call blue water, the rivers, the lakes, and the groundwater. So we are greatly interdependent with each other. It's not just the Amazon and the regions around the Amazon where you get a large flow of moisture in the atmosphere. If you take this part of the world, Southeast Asia imports atmospheric moisture from Australia and New Zealand, and that eastern stretch of the Asia Pacific. And Southeast Asia, in turn, exports moisture to China and Northeast Asia. It's a very significant flow of moisture that makes us interdependent. There's another reason why we are interdependent, and that is that the water cycle is inextricably linked with the climate challenge we face. Water is not just a casualty of the climate challenge in ways that everyone understands, the droughts, the heat waves and wildfires and so on. Water is also a cause or a driver of the climate challenge because the carbon stores in the wetlands and in the soil and in the forests are being diminished because of our mismanagement of water, our degradation of the wetlands, our over-extraction of groundwater. Our mismanagement of water is itself a driver of climate change. We are losing the stores of carbon, and increasingly, the natural ecosystems that used to be able to sequester carbon are becoming net emitters of carbon. So we're really in a vicious cycle, and that's another reason why we must understand the interdependence. It's not just about the rivers and the lakes. It's really about that link between the water cycle and the climate cycle. But I'm optimistic because water is solvable. We can solve the water crisis. We can coordinate internationally. We can take actions in our national interests that can solve this crisis. We have the technologies. We can mobilize the finance. We've got to have the willingness to coordinate and collaborate with each other. But we can solve this crisis. If you like, water is the low-hanging fruit in addressing the much broader challenge of climate and biodiversity.
Thank you, Mr. President. You mentioned that the problems and the crisis of water are caused by men, and perhaps a solution will also lie in the heads of men as well. And this is probably a good time for us to talk a little bit about the possibility of the importance of water innovation and the water adaptation. Now, as we know, changes to the global hydrological cycle have led to unprecedented flood, storms, drought, heat waves here today and there tomorrow. So Today, one child under the age of 5 dies every 80 seconds from diseases caused by water pollution. 2 billion people yet to have access to safe water. The Global Commission for the Economy of Water, which you mentioned that you have the privilege to co-chair, published a report last year. In it, it states that we must drive down the cost of technologies by adopting them at scale. So solutions seem to lie in innovation and adaptation. So the question is, how can we move from the path of mutually assured destruction to mutually assured prosperity across all fronts, including policy, science, innovation, adaptation, and you mentioned earlier, investment?
Well, the reason why I said water is the low-hanging fruit in the broader climate and biodiversity challenge is because I think we've reached a turning point where the innovations required to solve the water crisis are now within our reach. A fair number are within our reach within this decade, and most of them are within our reach in the next 3 decades. If you compare it to the climate challenge, it's broadly assessed that about 50% of the technologies required for us to reach net zero are already available, they're already mature, they need to be scaled up, and the cost needs to be driven down. About 50% of the technologies are available, and the other 50% are still at an experimental stage, green hydrogen, direct capture from the air, and so on. When it comes to water, I would say at least 75% of the technologies required for us to solve this crisis, to stabilize the global water cycle, are available. They're mature. And they too need to be scaled up. We need to drive them down the cost curve so that they can be scaled up all around the world, including in the developing world. And that's a great source for optimism. We have to organize it, we have to finance it, and we've got to create demand for these water technologies from the smallholder farmer to the industry that uses a lot of water. We've got to create that demand. And that's why it requires not just private markets, which are critical, but they will take a long time to solve this. You need public policy. You need public policy that incentivizes demand and incentivizes change on the part of those who are using water in agriculture, in industry, even in domestic use in households. And it can be done because we have lots of case studies around the world, cities as well as in rural areas, that are actually showing how you can conserve water, you can improve yields in farms, you can improve farmers' incomes, and you can have sustainable agriculture and sustainable industry. So the best practices that we see in cities, towns and rural areas around the world need to be scaled up. So I'm optimistic. Set ourselves challenges, work together to meet it, public and private sector within countries, find ways in which you get international support, particularly for the developing world, so they can scale up these solutions.
Right. So we need to drive across policy, science, R&D, technology development, investing and deployment of capital to be able to actually solve all the problems by putting all these things together.
And most importantly, I would say, start valuing water seriously. Start pricing water seriously. Mm-hmm. Subsidize the poor so they have access to clean water. But if we don't price water, we're going to discourage innovation, we're going to discourage water conservation, and it's going to be terrible for the poor. If you don't price water, it's terrible for the poor, because water will be used excessively in industry and by the largest farmers, by the largest users, and we won't have enough for the poor. So we've got to move away from the mindset which still exists in a lot of international discussion that thinks of water pricing as something that's inequitable. It's exactly the opposite way around. Water pricing is necessary for us to conserve water and to use it more efficiently, to have more water available for those who are underserved today. And then we've got to accompany water pricing with appropriate subsidies. Subsidies for the poor, subsidies for the small farmer, and very importantly, get rid of the bad subsidies. because we've got about $700 billion of subsidies each year spent on encouraging people to use water excessively or use energy excessively, including fossil fuels. So we've got to redirect those subsidies to good use so that we encourage sustainable practices and we support the poor.
I think on the note of pricing water right and correctly, it is important to understand we have to price natural capital correctly as well. And I think we all understand about financial capital, we know social capital, we know human capital, but very little is understood or talked about in terms of natural capital. So the United Nations Earth Summit, if I can bring us back to the Rio de Janeiro Earth Summit in the year 1992, and that particular summit had some very significant deliverables. Among them, UN Framework Convention on Climate Change, and of course, the Convention on Biological Diversity. So in a way, climate change and biodiversity loss were identified as nature's existential threats at around the same time, 32 years ago. Since then, of course, overwhelming science and evidence has turned climate crisis, or rather turned climate from crisis into accounting, and accounting then translated into policy making, corporate responsibility, consumer behavior, all of which very good. But as we know, we're all loath to subject our children into financial debt, and I think we are now loath to subject our children into climate debt. But I think we are quite nonchalant about subjecting our children and future generations into nature debt. Why is that? And the notion of natural capital remains a very fuzzy concept to even the most informed segment of our community. What can we do to correct this?
That's a very good question that Robin has asked. We've got to make it less fuzzy, the whole concept of natural capital. First, we are addressing a reality. If you take water, water doesn't come from the tap. It comes from natural ecosystems. It comes from natural ecosystems that evaporate and transpire water in the precipitation. That's the global water cycle. And it means we've got to preserve the natural ecosystems, be they forests or wetlands, or ensuring we're not over-extracting from rivers or over-extracting from groundwater. And in order for us to preserve that instinct of conserving water and conserving the ecosystem that produces water and all the benefits we get from water, we've got to first account for it. We've got to know where it is. We've got to know every resource that leads to this supply for water. And we've got to value it. If we don't value it, there's no incentive to it to preserve it. And this is, I think, now catching on, because in fact, at the COP for biodiversity in Kunming last year, there was a major move forward, an agreement to start accounting for natural capital. I think we are at very early stages of this process, and there's a lot of work ahead. There's a lot of work ahead, first in just getting the data together, having a systematic way of mapping natural resources, including water resources, and then having to value the benefits we get. I think we'll have to approach this both top-down through international agreements and the coordination required through scientific work, as well as bottom-up. And bottom-up, there's already movement. Countries are now taking very seriously the mapping of their natural resources, their natural capital. In fact, the Philippines is a very good example. That started last year on a systematic approach to geomapping, geospatial mapping of all its natural resources, with water in mind as well, so that it knows exactly where its resources are and what needs to be preserved. Companies are moving. Some companies are heavy users of water. We were all enjoying the beer that was given to us, nice special particular variant of beer. All the drinks manufacturers use a lot of water, naturally. Coca-Cola, Pepsi, Heineken, and so on. But these companies now realize, especially the leaders in the field, they realize that it's an unsustainable business unless they invest upstream in the natural catchments, help farmers to use water more efficiently, and treat that as part of their business model, help conserve natural catchments. They all realize that it's now unsustainable, and they are adopting various forms of natural capital accounting in its primitive form at the very least, because they know it's in their own interest. They might not be mandated to do it now, but they know 10 years, 15 years from now, it's going to be necessary. So they might as well take the lead. And I'm quite impressed by what some of them are doing. Danone is another example. Olam happens to be Singapore-based. It's another very good example that has natural capital accounting systematically in its business. And it knows that it has to preserve sustainability upstream, not just in the plant where it's doing the manufacturing or the processing. It's got to preserve it upstream in order to sustain the business. So I think we need both the top-down approach, which eventually has to translate into regulatory practices and disclosure practices, just like we've achieved for carbon. We have to move on to biodiversity and water. And I would say water, even there, is the low-hanging fruit because it's much more specifically defined compared to the biodiversity. But we also need to get a lot more voluntary action on the part of corporates, with the largest corporates being able to take the lead, because they know that 10 years from now, this is unsustainable. They've got to have a way of valuing and preserving the natural ecosystems on which their business depends.
On a regulatory note, I recall some years back, there was no requirement for us to disclose anything on sustainability and climate. Now we do. Do you see the day that will come, and perhaps soon, that we will have to disclose on nature?
I think it's inevitable. And like I say, the COP in Kunming last year was a major step forward. But it's a lot of hard work. We are still at a very early stage of that process.
Right. The President has very graciously agreed to take questions from the floor. I do have one more to ask very quickly. And then this is to signal you that you have a question that you have in mind. Please raise your hand. And I think we'll be able to take a couple of questions before we round up the session. The last question, President. As in all things, it helps to have money and to solve the problem of climate or biodiversity and water crisis, we need some money. Money, as we know, gravitates towards where the risk return reward is the best, and advancing nature, unfortunately, doesn't appear to be that, at least not now. So how can capital owners, investors, companies, NGOs, governments all get together and then to deploy capital to preserve biodiversity and invigorate nature's ecosystem by adding moisture to the life cycle?
Well, you know, when I mentioned that water innovation is at a turning point, it's at a turning point not only because the technologies are now mature and available, but because it's an investable opportunity. You can earn a decent return from water innovation. In every sector, if you take agriculture, the techniques of micro-irrigation, the techniques of regenerative agriculture that improve soil health, pay back the investor, be it a farmer or an external investor, relatively quickly, because this is a mature technology. Within 6 months to 1.5 years, you get a payback on your investment. If you take the circular water economy, recycling of water, generating value even out of wastewater, it's an investable opportunity. If you take the most basic humanitarian objective, which is making sure that no child need die from lack of access to clean water, there's so much to be done by way of investment. Investment in decentralized wastewater treatment, and in fact, there are several companies in Singapore that are doing that. There's a very interesting project based in NTU, Nanyang Technological University, that's doing it in Myanmar. There's a company called Aterra that's doing it in Vietnam. Low-cost, affordable, small-scale water treatment using reverse membrane technologies, using membranes with special carbon particles. All these need to be scaled up. they're affordable, they earn a decent return, and they're good for the communities that we're engaging in. So we've got to avoid looking at the world as having a set of problems that are of a humanitarian nature and require only public capital, and another world, another half of the world, as being investment capital driven by the private sector. They're actually the same world. We've got to look for investable opportunity everywhere, enable communities to benefit from investment, and ensure that capital can be recycled because it earns a return. That's the only realistic strategy, because the public sector globally does not have infinite resources. In fact, it's running out of resources. And the task of public policy nationally and multilaterally has to be to mobilize private capital by providing it with some regulatory certainty, sometimes providing it with an incentive as well, or some sharing of risk, because there is opportunity for investment in solving these large problems of the commons.
Thank you, Mr. President. And yes, gentlemen over there, can you please just tell us who you are? And if you can make your question rather succinct, I'll be able to take one more. Do I see another hand so I
hello?
Can take both questions at the same time? Just give me a second, please. Yes. Do I see a second hand? So the yes, gentlemen over there. Okay, I will stop with the two questions. Please go ahead.
Sure. I have, since 2008, been part of this conference. And in 2008, I had the opportunity to sit with Lee Kuan Yew and understand the essence of this prize. And this is the first time that I've heard anyone articulate so much the voice, the vision, and embrace that. So you understand probably more about water than most of the people in this room from what I've just heard. So I just want to compliment you on that. But for me, as I travel around the world as representing the value that Singapore has done in the water economy and a lot of the things that you described, is that Singapore has accomplished so much. It's like the Silicon Valley of technology. But where do you think Singapore can play the next role? It's already been an example about the four national taps, the water. Mm-hmm. You have a vision. But how does Singapore take what you have articulated and spread that over the world?
Okay, the next lap. Gentleman over there, please go ahead.
Yeah, Christopher Gass on Global Water Intelligence. I was just asking, what proportion of Temasek's portfolio do you think should be held in water-related assets? What proportion is it now, and what should it be in future?
You can Thank
ask you. Each other that question.
Well, two very good questions. On the first, I think Singapore's realization from its very outset, and Mr. Lee Kuan Yew's leadership insistence, was on water being existential for our country. And the good news is, as I started off this discussion on, that water is now becoming existential for every country. So Singapore had no choice but to innovate, to take it very seriously. It wasn't just the responsibility of one minister or one agency. It became a cabinet responsibility, a whole of government responsibility, and in fact, a whole of society responsibility, as it is in the Netherlands and some other countries. And we now need that same cast of mind everywhere. Water is becoming existential. Our role is modest because we are a small country, but we can be a testbed for experimentation. Not just experimentation in the lab, but experimentation in the field. And I'm quite encouraged by the fact that there's a whole set of companies that are coming up. Some are Singaporean or Singapore-based, some are foreign companies that are coming to Singapore to collaborate with our universities or with other companies here, that are spawning experiments everywhere in Asia, from agriculture to industrial wastewater recycling. I think the other role we can play, besides scaling up innovation, is in blended finance, which we take very seriously in Singapore, because that has to be the investment finance solution. It's not going to be the public sector by itself, and the private sector on its own will not move fast enough. We need blended finance to spur the process, to front load the innovations. And we think it can be done. And we want Asia to be not a laggard, but a leader in this area. On Christopher Gasson's question, first, I can't answer on the behalf of Temasek. Even if I was still part of the government doesn't answer on behalf of Temasek. But I must say, I'm impressed by Temasek's commitment to climate, water, and biodiversity. It sees it as an investment, part of the investment universe. And it sees that intersection between decent investment returns and doing good for the planet. And that, I think, is a huge opportunity. Beyond Temasek, it's a huge opportunity. Climate, water, and biodiversity are the largest investment opportunities we've seen in 50 years. Investments in innovations that are mature and can be scaled up, investments of a higher risk in the more experimental technologies that are not yet mature, but out of which will come successful technologies with very high returns. We've got to think of it globally, because the largest opportunities are actually in the developing world, but there's appetite for it now amongst leading players in the investment world.
We've ended right on time. We thank you for the questions. Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the Republic of Singapore.
Thank you, President Tharman and Mr. Hu, for the enlightening dialogue session and for sharing your invaluable insights with us today. May we invite you back to your seats, please.